So, Spurs taking on Leicester this weekend. The Foxes have a go at stopping the Premier League's premier couple, Son and Kane. Son, of course, on target yet again this Wednesday. He's got 3 goals in his last 5 appearances, scoring against City, Arsenal and Liverpool. He also, Thursday night, picked up the Puskas Award for 2020's best goal, that wonderful breakaway move against Burnley. His ownership in FPL is over 60%. It's remarkable, mainly because that means there's around 40% of managers who don't have him. Given how well he suits Jose's style, and given how well that style is usually working for Spurs, why don't people have him? Janny and Lee, do you both have Son?
I do have Son, yeah. What about Janny?
I don't, no.
Why?
I'm buying Harry Kane this week. I'm not quite
ready.
You've
had neither.
Yeah, I've gone for neither for the last sort of 4 or 5 games. I had them both. I sold them both for the tricky games. The plan was to get one back. I don't want both because that means you can't have KDB, Salah, Bruno. So you've just got to pick and choose and commit to one of these guys. For me, I prefer Harry Kane just. I think the Jose system definitely suits Son and, of course, he's more affordable.
Right.
But I like the appeal of penalties for Kane and I also think that his numbers will continue to grow whilst I think Son's might start to dip because he's massively been outperforming his expected goals. He's just been really, really clinical.
Oh, Gianni, you have to consider having both of these. You honestly do. I've got both of these in my team right now. Kane, I massively fancy. He's got a great record against Leicester. But forget XG, forget all of that. These guys, both of them, are clinical elite finishers. Son has shown doesn't have to have too many chances. He puts them away every time.
There's also something about Lee having both of them in your team because they've combined for so many goals this season.
Yeah.
When one of them scores, you almost expect it's the other one that's assisted them.
They're totally on each other's wavelength, aren't they? And actually, the other players in that Spurs team, they put the graft in. Not that these guys don't, they obviously work hard, but you've got Steven Bergwijn there, a workhorse. You've got the Højbjergs in midfield doing a lot of the work. These guys are just therefore free to be the artists in that team and they are totally on each other's wavelength. If Kane assists Son or Son assists Kane, you're not surprised.
Gianni, Harry Kane, and you've just said that you're planning on bringing him into your team this week and we will see both of your teams a little bit later. But Harry Kane's actually failed to have a shot on target in 3 of his last 5 matches. But is it the fixtures that are appealing to you, why you want to get him in now? Because they're looking quite nice after this game at the weekend.
Yeah, I mean, Harry Kane's a flat-track bully. You look at those fixtures, Fulham at home, Leeds at home, they're definitely captaincy options. I feel like against weaker oppositions, Kane is one that will turn up and just go, yeah, brace, hat-trick. Son will score against, you know, all teams. And when Spurs are playing a counter-attack style, like they will against the likes of Liverpool, which we've seen recently, Son will score on the break. But Kane, he's a bully. I like that in FPL. Mm.
You planning on holding, Lee, for all of these, with both of them?
Without a doubt. Without a doubt. I think Kane's got 10 goals in his last 7 games against Leicester, including, I think, 4 in a game a couple of seasons ago. So he looks great for this for captaincy this week. But, yeah, stick his mate in there as well. Why not?
Excellent. What about Spurs defensively? They did have that run of 4 clean sheets. They haven't been able to keep the goals out in the last 2 game weeks. But are you expecting a lot of clean sheets over this kind of busy festive period?
Yeah, why not? And if you want to get invested in Eric Dier at 5.0 million, they're keeping a lot of clean sheets. That is Mourinho's style, as we know. The focus is on defence. The rotation bothers me a little bit with Reguilón going forward.
Yeah.
And at 5.7, you want somebody that's rotation-proof.
Yeah, Dier's not the sexiest of players to bring in.
Well, you say that. It was only a few days back, he took a free kick from 30 yards and he knuckleballed it. He had the Ronaldo-style swerve. And as soon as I saw that, I thought, OK, if he's going to be on free kicks, as well as being only 5 million, in a Jose Mourinho team, which we know historically keep loads of clean sheets, I'm actually looking to bring him in the next fortnight.
Really?
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Very interesting. Well, talking of those clean sheets and that defence that Jose Mourinho has shored up with Tottenham, how do you think that will affect Jamie Vardy's chances of delivering this weekend, Lee?
Well, it's interesting that Jamie Vardy, particularly on the road this season, has been very, very good. 68% of his points have come on the road. Obviously, going to Spurs, therefore, shouldn't hold too much fear for him. It's Man United at home after that, and then Crystal Palace and Newcastle both away. So 4 away games, sorry, 3 in his next 4. Looks all right for Vardy.
I'm a little bit concerned about this because I have Vardy, and you're quite right. At home, when teams come and they defend, there's no room for him to play
into.
He doesn't get the room to do his magic. But when you go away to Spurs, you know that Mourinho loves to play that kind of football. Do you think he's actually going to perform this weekend?
It'll be very interesting to see what mentality Mourinho's Spurs take. I mean, they're at home. You'd like to think that they're going to press a little bit more and not take the same mentality they did against Liverpool and Man City and Chelsea recently. Sit back, absorb it and hit on the counter-attack. they've got to be a bit more ambitious, surely. But then both these teams like that counter-attack, so, I don't know, maybe we'll just cancel each other out and they'll just keep looking at each other for 90 minutes, I don't know. But it'll be very interesting to see whether Vardy can break that, that Spurs back line.
Brilliant. All right, one other Leicester player called Jamie, coincidentally, James Maddison. Jenny, yeah. He's begun to return a little bit after a slow start of the season. I think he's on 6 goals now this season. Blank this week. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, with him out injured at the start of the season, couldn't get a run of games. You know, we didn't like that. He's dropped in price. But now he's starting to return. And Brendan Rodgers is starting to put quite an attacking lineup out. I think with the likes of Maddison, Barnes, we've seen Under, all in behind Vardy, that should lead to more and more goals. For me, it's a bit of a wait and see on Maddison. I want consistency from him, and we've not had that up till now.
Yeah, I'm still hurting from that rocket he scored against Brighton last week.
That's a good one, though.
What about James Justin? Do you think he's going to keep his place long term? He can play on the left or the right, we've seen.
Yeah, he's pretty versatile, isn't he? I worry about his minutes once Ricardo Pereira's back and fit, but I haven't seen a timescale for that. I've seen him in a couple of training pitches, but then not in the matchday squad, so I don't know quite what's going on with him.
Pereira. He played in the Europa League, didn't he? And then came off, I think, at half-time or something.
Yeah, so there's something not quite right with whatever the niggle is that he's got. So James Justin looks pretty good value at 4.9. They defended fantastically well against your boys against Brighton when Ndidi was back and playing in midfield. Because of the Johnny Evans suspension, they put Ndidi at centre-half and it just didn't work against Everton, did it? But once Ndidi's back in midfield, the defence are investable again.
It's time to talk about Kevin De Bruyne. He is FPL royalty, or at least he has been for several seasons now. But what's going on in this campaign? We've got some numbers there that reflect his performance so far this season. As you can see, still plenty of chances created, 36, 10 of them big chances, a whopping 6 assists. 40 shots, which sounds great until you look at the next figure, only 2 goals, and they were both penalties, none from open play whatsoever. Janny, you've got him. Jules, you have 2. Do you hold? What's your thinking right now with Kevin?
Yeah, I am holding because I want Man City coverage. And he's the only one that we know will play every week. Or, you know, at least he has done up till now. We've been really unlucky, us KDB owners. He's hit the woodwork a couple of times as my captain. But also, the big chances. He's been putting it on a plate for players that just haven't been putting the ball in the back of the net. And Aguero out has definitely played a part in that. Aguero on the pitch, KDB assists flooding.
Why do you not have him, Lee? Aside from the fact that you have to pick, tell us why you didn't pick him.
I've got a bit of a broader problem with Man City this season. I think they've lacked a little bit of their ruthlessness. You know, the way they kind of settled for that draw in the Manchester derby, the way they didn't kind of put Fulham to the sword at the Etihad. Now, I appreciate they went and beat Burnley 5-0 as well, and he did pretty well in that game. But I just don't think they're getting the 3, 4 and 5 nils that we're used to from Man City. So, at 11.9, you know, Aubameyang's got more goals from open play.
Dear.
No one's got him.
Yeah.
So. Wow. I'm not on Kevin at the minute.
All right, let's take a look at his points for each game week then. And as you can see here, the ones that are highlighted are his double-digit hauls. Only 3 in 13 game weeks. I mean, that's not good enough, is it?
That level of consistency doesn't...
It's actually 12 game weeks because he didn't play in the first one.
Yeah, I mean, that...
Or the fifth one.
That can...
So it's 10.
It's a great record.
I can't count.
When you see only 3 with double digits, though, it doesn't give you confidence to want to give him the armband. And at that price, KDB, we should be every week thinking, is he a captaincy option? But when you look at those numbers, he's probably not, because you want consistency with your captains.
Yeah.
All right, that's what he's done so far. What do the fixtures look like coming up for Man City? Well, there's lots of green there. But as you mentioned, Lee, he's been through plenty of fixtures, and Man City have, that you'd expect them to score big points in, and they really haven't.
Well, yeah, I mean, if you do own Kevin De Bruyne, I don't think you worry too much. I mean, when he played against West Brom last game week, West Brom played very, very well, very defensively disciplined in that 4-1-4-1. Probably their best defensive performance under Bilic, and then he gets the hook straight afterwards. So I wouldn't worry too much about, you know, Southampton, Everton, Chelsea, these are games where that, you know, that low block, that disciplined defensive display is unlikely to be employed by any of those 3 teams. So he could have joy against those.
As well as the fixtures looking good, Gianni, you already alluded to it. Kevin De Bruyne, when he's fit, he plays. So although we talk about this concern with Pep Roulette, when you actually look, he's played almost the most minutes of any of the other Man City players so far this season. 3rd on that list to the goalkeeper and Rodri.
Yeah, so when you're looking at attacking Man City assets, he is the one.
Yeah.
He's also playing in a position which is way higher up the pitch. This season, we're seeing him as a traditional number 10. He's playing in a midfield three with two holding players, Gundogan and Rodri. In years gone by, he shared that responsibility with a David Silva, so we should see that position and think we're going to get even more attacking returns. Mm. But we've just not seen it. And he's been on penalties this year, which we've not seen. With Aguero coming back, though, he may not continue on penalties.
There's a good opportunity to rest him in the League Cup as well. There's a League Cup round coming up. So I think if Pep's going to rest him, probably going to be in that game. So in the Premier League, I wouldn't worry too much.
Okay. To have a little look at his rate of points per game, because it's not that he's doing disastrously. In fact, if he continues on his current rate of scoring, I think he'll finish up the season with 202 points. Last season, he finished with about 250. A couple of years ago, he also finished on about 202. And I think everyone was pretty happy with those returns. The difference being this year, his price is almost 12 million. He's been around that figure all season. For that money, should we be expecting more? Should you be expecting more for your money, Jani?
Yeah, and I really am. The assist numbers will continue to clock up. It's just the goals. And he is shooting lots. You know, we're seeing more shots this season than we did last. It's just he's not able to put the ball in the back of the net, which is a real surprise, knowing how accurate he is with his passing. He perhaps isn't with his finishing this season. But I do think that will change. With those fixtures, it's just impossible to sell him.
Well, when we talk Liverpool, we have to talk about Mr. Mo Salah first of all. Because of that goal against Tottenham midweek, it means that Mo Salah has now returned in each of his last six Premier League appearances. And this is now his best ever start to a Premier League campaign.
Wow.
He's got 102 fantasy points, fantasy-wise, that is. Yeah. 102 fantasy points. Remember, his best ever season was in 2017-18 when he got 303 points at the end of the season. He's actually on more than that this season. So, I mean, we could see another record.
Are we going to get another record-breaking season from Mo Salah?
Yeah.
We might do. I mean, with Liverpool's fixtures over the next four or five games as well, they are prime for Salah to get points. It doesn't matter whether you have a team that's going to play a low block or a team that comes and plays expansive football. Liverpool's away form has to improve, no doubt. They're not that great on the road at the minute. But if you've got Salah and he's at home, he's captaincy against anybody.
He's had a nice little rest as well. We know he wasn't obviously playing in the internationals because of his positive COVID test, but Klopp has said he wasn't showing symptoms, so he missed a couple of Premier League games, the international break. He's had the best part of three, 4 weeks off, so he's fresh for this December period, which historically he's not been. And I'm with you, he's a really nice captain's shout in the next couple of weeks. Yeah,
he's definitely... Said that, if you don't own him, those last couple of goals he scored, that penalty against Fulham was a little bit jammy, and then the deflection against Spurs. But listen, as a Salah owner, I'm going to take it.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Are either of you Mane owners?
No, not for me. It's Mo Salah all day long. You can't have both this season. I'm really struggling.
Can you not?
I don't think so. Not if you want the Spurs assets, and if you want KDB or Bruno as well. It's too many premiums.
So the next three, Palace, West Brom and Newcastle, thought of having those two. Having goes at those three defences is quite an enticing
prospect. Sounds like you're thinking about it, Jamesy.
Well, yeah, I'm putting the notion out there.
I mean, why not? It'd be a fantastic differential to do. It's a hell of a lot of your budget to spend just on the Liverpool midfield.
I can tell you why not. Actually, he hasn't scored a goal since game week five. That would be the reason. But then again, those three defences might look inviting to
you. Yeah, having said that, yes, he hasn't scored for a long time, but the XG stats, but the expected goals have been pretty good for Mane. He's right up there in terms of the XG for Liverpool players. One off the bar against Spurs, a bit unlucky against Fulham as well, potentially. So the goals could be coming for Mane, and I think he's still a really nice differential.
OK. Mm.
We all lost a bit of faith in Liverpool's defence, didn't we, after all the injuries that they sustained. A lot of managers shipped the likes of Robertson and Trent out of their teams, but Robertson got another assist on Wednesday against Tottenham. He's owned by just 18% of managers. Trent's owned by 13% of managers. They're now kind of looking like differentials, Gianni. Would you be tempted?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, Robertson as well this season, what we've not seen with Robertson in the past is the set pieces. And Liverpool score a lot of set piece goals. Even with Virgil van Dijk out the team, they're still scoring them, as we've recently seen. So Robertson on free kicks and corners, even with Trent in the team, that's really positive if you're a Robbo owner, because we know he likes to bomb forward as well. So at that price point, you do need attacking returns, but with him, you get them.
Yeah. Lee, you're a Liverpool fan. Mm. Tell us, is it worth investing?
Well, I had Robertson in my team up until this game week,
no!
And he was the sacrificial lamb to bring Bruno in as captain, so that didn't work out for me. But with the wild card, the next January wild card on the horizon, one of these guys will be back. I think it's going to be Trent. I think it's going to be Trent. He's FPL royalty. You know what you're going to get with him, direct free kicks as well as corners and set pieces. And I still have that haul against Leicester away in my head from last season where he got the 24-pointer. So I think I'll be bringing Trent in the new year.
Okay. Lee, as an avid follower of Liverpool, what's your thoughts on Curtis Jones? 19 years of age, 4.4 million, so super cheap.
Absolutely.
He's played the full 90 in the last three league fixtures. He had six shots, created four chances. Are we looking at a real bargain there? We haven't had the returns yet, but are they on the way?
Well, it could be, yeah. I mean, I'm struggling to see how Thiago gets in this team when he's fit, because Curtis Jones has come through and done a fantastic job. Second in game week 13 against Spurs for touches in the opposition half, by the way. Only Robertson had more touches than him in the entire game week, all clubs, all players. So Curtis Jones was getting forward into those areas that we like midfielders to get into. I think in the past, you would have gone, or maybe not, because I don't want to use up one of my Liverpool slots. But I think if you have Salah, you could easily complement him with Jones at 4.4 and still then invest in either Trent or Robertson as well.
OK, let's start off by quickly reminding ourselves of some of the key fixtures then coming up in game week 14. Liverpool are heading to Palace, Southampton face Man City, Tottenham take on Leicester, and it's Manchester United against Leeds. They're some of the matches we think there could be some big hauls in. So, Lee, who's the armband going on for you this week?
Well, do you know what? I like that comment about big hauls. And Manchester United Leeds has got goals written all over it, hasn't it? Defensive assets at a premium. I'll probably bench Dallas again in that fixture. But I think for me, it's going to be Harry Kane for all the reasons we mentioned before. Good record against Leicester. Spurs in obviously good form, despite what happened at Anfield. So I think I'll be going for Harry Kane.
You'll mention that at any opportunity you can.
I've waited until right at the end of the show to mention that, Joel.
Jenny, you're talking about Kane or Bruno Fernandes, is that right?
Yeah, and it's a really, really difficult one.
Wait, so what happened to your always captain Mo Salah policy?
Yeah, I wish I could stick to that. That would be a really brave thing to do all season, just go with
Mo. It would have worked this week.
It always would have. Every season gone by, it would have been way better for me.
All right, so they got Palace away, Liverpool, but what do you think between Kane and Fernandes?
Yeah, I think Kane is perhaps just edging it. I mean, both these guys, interestingly enough, have blanked in the game week just gone. Yeah. But, you know, Kane, I just feel like Mourinho's going to get into that Spurs team after they lost to Liverpool, tell them that title challenges still. Kane's going to be fired up to score against one of his old teams. I've not been impressed with Leicester's defence in recent weeks either. Yeah, we've seen Ndidi at centre-back, we've seen a back five, we've seen a back four. I'd like Kane.
Yeah.